Okay, I think we'd like to start. Yeah. So it's a pleasure and an honor to be asked to introduce Kengo Kuma. And I just would just say a few words about his career to date, which is hard to keep up with since he's constantly winning one competition after another, mostly in Europe, and constantly traveling as a consequence of that. He was born in Yokohama in 54. He graduated from Tokyo University with a Master in Architecture in 1979. As it happens, that's 3 years after Tadao Ando began his career in 76 with his famous Sumiyoshi house, which was, as it turned out, was a house that, that Kengo didn't really care for very much. But this didn't stop him succeeding Ando as a professor at Tokyo University, which he currently holds this position. He actually graduated from the AAD program here at Columbia in 1986 and went back to Japan, opened up a small practice under the title Spatial Design in 87. But Kengo Kuma Associates was started in 1990 and, in fact, has been going for 23 years and has branched off of recent date into Kengo Kuma Associates Europe, which is another branch of the same endless creativity. The very key work in his life, I think, and he is in the habit of emphasizing this, but perhaps tonight he will not do so, is this famous water glass project of 1995, which was built adjacent to a house by Bruno Taut. And in fact, Bruno Taut occupies a very prominent place in his life story, so to speak, because his father was very close to Bruno Taut and collected various design objects made by Bruno Taut. And as you probably know, Bruno Taut played an extraordinary role in Japan, in as much as he, as much as anybody else, reevaluated the importance of the Katsura Palace, Taut being in Tokyo from 1933 to 1936. The water glass house is very typical of Kuma's work in that it there is a kind of perceptual problem of boundaries, or rather not a problem, but a kind of rich effect of ambiguous boundaries that are constantly changing, partly to do with the relationship between glass, flowing water, the sea, and the horizon, since the house is the water glass house overlooks Atami Bay. And I think I don't have too much more to say, except he just recently won, for an example of the competitions outside Japan, in 2010, he won the first prize for a conservatory in Dundee, Scotland. In 2008, or prior to that, he won a performing arts building in Granada, Spain. He's recently won a campus building for the EPFL in Lausanne and a station near Torino. And so it goes. With great pleasure, I give you Tadao and Kengo Kuma.
thank you very much, Professor Clampton. When I studied here, as in 1985 to 86, I learned many things from him. Probably his experience here is very, very important. And it's a kind of critical moment for myself. From Japan, Japanese context to the Western context, and also from the reality to another reality. And the topic of today is the disaster. as you know, we had a disaster last year, the tsunami and earthquake and the Fukushima. And I found how the disasters affect the architectural design. I want to start from the this the image. And this was the Lisbon big earthquake, the 1751, the November 1st. After that, the kind of the international design started, I think. And probably some of you know this history. More than 50 or 60,000 people died in that disaster. And comparing with last year's the disaster, this around 20,000 people died. Is much bigger than the earthquake last year. And after that, after that, this kind of the design started. It's a kind of the geometrical design, so with the science and the technology, and the people would like to go to this direction. So people hated the chaos and of Lisbon, and they wanted to create the isolated object. It is far from the existing context of Lisbon. And this kind of urban design also started after Lisbon. The geometry as a big street, as a big plaza, and after that, the Chicago big fire. It's 1871. Not so many people died, but the Chicago was the city of wood and brick before that, and then Chicago was going to this direction. Big concrete and steel building and the strong building. And that direction is going to that kind of big building. And same thing happened in Japan. It's 1923 is a big earthquake. And we called it last big earthquake. And the Ginza was like that after big earthquake. So this is Ginza Street, as very few buildings survived. As most of the building is a one-story, two-story wooden building, is destroyed, is burned. And more than 100,000 people died. As comparing with last year's, this is 100,000 was big numbers. And after the disasters, Japan changes the direction. The government changed the regulation very much, and the new direction is going to the strong cities with the concrete and the steel and the to avoid the doom building as possible and make the street as wide as possible. And then probably it was necessary at that time, but we lost the most the valuable thing in Japanese culture, and that the value was deeply related with wooden building, the building with the local material, and we abandoned that method. We abandoned as a connection with a place, and then we also went to a different direction. And finally, and this was Ishinomaki, I took these pictures by myself. I told you the story afterward, the thing happened. And I took these pictures April 2nd, 3 weeks after tsunami. And still the situation was like that. I was so surprised to see that situation. Three weeks passed, but still like that. And today's topic is, what is the lesson from the big earth, this disaster. What was the, can be the new direction after the disaster? And we should think about that. Because as the architectural history is always as a deeply as a influenced by big disasters, and the change of the direction of designs happened after disaster. And the probably same thing will happen. And but the for me the first big change after Columbia is the burst of bubble. In 1990s the was not a happy decade for Japanese because economy was so bad. The burst of bubble happened in 1992, and I couldn't find project in Tokyo in 10 years. And I did travel as in the countryside of Japan, and I worked with local craftsmen for a small project. And my first project in 1990s was this project. So this is Kilozan Observatory, and it looks like a mountain, but I designed this mountain. The story was this section, shows this section. The client of this project, the mayor of the small village, prepares the flat land, and his request was very simple. To build the concrete monument on this flat land. This is a typical mentality of the as politicians in before 1980s. But I didn't like his request. And my solution was like that. To cast concrete like that, bring the earth, as a vegetation again, and finally, I could go back to this situation. And this is the space we created. So he asked me to design the monument, the object, sculptures on the flat land, but what I did was opposite from his thinking. And it's a kind of void. And so 3 years after the completion, so we could have this situation. And this is my favorite pictures. But as a architectural magazine didn't use. They said, this is nothing, Kuma-san, this is nothing. But I think this is everything that I want to achieve. And the next project is a very similar project in Miyagi Prefecture. Actually, it is in Ishinomaki City, Kitakami Canal Museum. This is a project we did. This is Kitakami River. The Kitakami Canal started here. And one third of the building is on the ground, and the two third is underground. So Kitakami River, the Kitakami Canal, this is a plan. The building is like a tunnel, and this is the exhibition space. And this is some kind of plaza. Oops. So wait, is this, do you know how to cancel that? The computer is hidden. It's a hidden architecture. Is there yes, good. Okay. The sensor is okay. This is this is a sections, and the Kitakami River is here. The Ishinomaki City is here. And this is the entrance from Ishinomaki City. And then I should come back to March 11. On that day, I was in Taiwan. And the earthquake happened, the 246. And just after the earthquake, the Taiwan TV started to show the what happened in Ishinomaki. And this is very, it's very, very fast, it's just after the earthquake. And the Taiwan people told me something happened in your country, but I knew the field. It's surprisingly shocking. And I suddenly found the Ishinomaki was almost no hope to survive. And I tried to call my family, I tried to call my office, but of course no connection on that day. And then I tried to call this museum, but of course no connection. And I gave up the hope, it's very desperate. But 2 weeks after the earthquake, suddenly I could talk with them. The connection recovered. And they said, Kuma-san, we are okay. The building's still there. I am surprised. As honestly saying, I'm so surprised. Why you're saved? And they said, this is Kitakami Rivers. And this is very close from the ocean. And if tsunami happened, the river is winding, one side is damaged, but opposite side is okay. This is the nature of tsunami. And then this side is devastated, but this side is okay. And this building is very, very lucky in that sense. This is the bottom of the building. And then the next week, 3 weeks after tsunami, I visited here, but almost no damage for the building. There's many cracks on the land, but the building itself is all right. But the surprisingly, the river, the look flooded. And the reason is all the land of Ishinomaki dropped 1 meter. All the land, the city itself dropped 1 meter. And I couldn't believe it. And that means the water level of the river has raised 1 meter. And then it looks like flood. And it's different. The raised 1 meters, and the width of the river is expanded, and those buildings are very much damaged. And I found how nature is strong, and anything else can make by nature. This is a big lesson from that the tsunami. And what the human can do in that kind of the situation is to be humble, to respect nature. That is a big lesson. This is a beautiful river. And the next project in 1990s is Water Glass Villa, which Professor Flampton mentioned. And I start from this wooden box. This box, I don't know why, but my father bought this box in 1935 from the shop of Bruno Taut in Ginza. And the sponsor of that of the shop is Mr. Inoue, and behind the box, you can see the name Tauto Inoue. And it's a very strange story. This is my father's treasure. And whenever he drank beer, he brought that box. Please look at box, Kengo. And this is a great design by German architects. And today, even today, this box is in front of my desk, the balloon tout is looking what I'm doing. He's always checking what I'm doing. And the stories of balloon touts started in 1933. He visited Katsura Villa on the first day of his first visit to Japan. And please look at this bamboo, this hedge. So this is a gate of Katsura Villa. And in front of this hedge, balloon tout began to cry down. And his Japanese friend was so surprised. Why you cried? Not in the building. Before entering the villa, he began to cry. And Bruno Taut, the explanation is this hedge is his ideal example of harmony between nature and the artifact. So this is a, please look at this carefully. This is bamboo, it's not cut, it is just bended. And bended bamboo and this the structures is combined together to create the natural the hedge. It is really natural hedge. And then he found some ideal situation. And he went as he get in the building, and this is his favorite element of Katsura Villa. It's a bamboo terrace, and this horizontal element was connecting nature and architecture. And he wrote about Katsura Villa in Western architecture, the goal of architecture is beautiful shape. But in Japan, it's not. In Japan, the goal is the creating relationship, happy relationship between nature and architecture. And his comment was very interesting, even for Japanese. And the story goes to this house, but before this house, the strange story is, after coming back from Colombia, I got a telephone call from Mr. Inoue. Mr. Inoue? He asked me to design the small project. It's not a big project, it's a facade design of his project. But I met him. And he was a guy who supported Bruno Taut, 1933. At that time, he was at the age of 92. Mr. Inoue, you are Mr. Inoue, who supported Bruno Taut 80 years ago. From now it's 80 years ago, but from 1986 is 50 years ago. He was still as active on that days. And I heard the interesting story between him and Bruno Taut. After he supported Bruno Taut, he asked Antonin Raymond to design the Gumma as a Philharmonic Hall. And you know Antonin Raymond, he was working with Frank Lloyd Wright for Imperial Hotel in Tokyo. So he supported Anthony Lemon. And after, I don't know why, he asked me to design the small project. And he was a big fan of architecture, this is a very, very memorial project for me. And next story is this house. This is Bruno Taut's designs only house in Japan, Hyuga House, completed 1936. This is a very strange design. Bruno Taut tried to create special sections to connect nature and architecture. And this section is very, very unique because the tatami room also has a kind of mezzanine, and also he used many interesting material, bamboo, and this is also made by bamboo. And when I designed this water glass villa, I visited the site before designing. As a, from next house, the one woman, one beautiful woman, as a came and she said, "So please look at my house." And I couldn't understand the meaning for me of what she said. Oh, why don't you get in the house? This is the house. This is very, very typical two-story wooden house, not designed by Bruno Taut, but this is a living room, and suddenly she opens a special door to the basement. And this is a garden. This is because this is Pashpikosh and this is cliff. And suddenly, this space designed by Bruno Taut was in front of me. Oh, wow, your house was designed by Bruno Taut. And that means I can design just next to Bruno Taut. And I'm so excited to hear that. And this is a kind of third encounter with Bruno Taut. And I decided to study Bruno Taut again for the design of this house. And these pine trees is a pine tree of Bruno Taut house. And this is another horizontal element which connect Pacific Ocean and our building. And this is same as the bamboo terrace of Katsura Villa. And the two horizontal element, this horizontal element, are connecting environment and building. The always edge is very important. And the next important project for me is the Hiroshige Museum in Nakagawa-machi. It's completed 2000. Please look at this beautiful wooden block by Hiroshige. As a historian pointed out that the difference between Japanese painting and the Western painting is shown clearly in this wooden block. And in Western painting, the contrast between nature and artifact is a main topic, main theme. But in Japanese and Asian painting, the nature and artifact is melting. And super juxtaposition is the main method to create the deepness. And please look at the super juxtaposition, so this vertical lanes and village and rivers and forest. And in Western painting, the lane is not straight lines. Always architecture is straight and nature is ambiguous, soft. But in Japanese and Asian painting, the lane sometimes straight and fog sometimes straight. And the natural phenomena and the artificial structures is belonging to the same world, that is the idea. And this is another example of super juxtaposition of space in Hiroshige. And this... Sorry for that. I should talk. So I should talk about the Vincent van Gogh hostel. Yes. And that artist, you, probably you know Vincent van Gogh, he respected Hiroshige very much, and he learned the Hiroshige's method from this wooden block. And then, the, if you have time to go to Amsterdam Gogh Museum, you can find this Hiroshige's a copy of Hiroshige. And he respected Hiroshige. He wrote by himself, "I respected Rembrandt, I respected Cezanne, and Hiroshige." It's the same level. It's a three person. And so probably what he learned from Hiroshige is the course of the impressionism, the super juxtaposition, and the how the harmony between nature and artifact. This is not working.
Which for which direction?
And that this is another evidence of his respect. And another the great artist, a good architect, who respected Hiroshige, is him, is Frank Lloyd Wright. And he learns the similar method from Hiroshige. This is a drawing of Lobby House, 1906. This method is very similar to the Hiroshige's method. Super juxtaposition, the melting nature and the artifact. And also he respected this guy. And in his Frank Lloyd Wright's autobiography, so before he passed away, he wrote, "Without to Japanese, I can't achieve anything." The two Japanese, one is Hiroshige, and another is Tenshin Okakura. He wrote the book of tea. He wrote in English, and you can read easily. This book is this is very interesting book. From them, I learned the method of void, the method of super juxtaposition, and the transparency. Wright wrote in his autobiography. And actually, the Frank Lloyd Wright came to Japan so often to buy the items of Hiroshige. And when he was young, he was not so rich. And it's a kind of a trade. He bought the Hiroshige's item in Japan, and he sold here instead to get money. It's a kind of alibite of him. And now, so if you can go to Boston Museum, there are many Hiroshige pieces. And most of the Hiroshige pieces in Boston Museum are through Frank Lloyd Wright. My Hiroshige Museum is a kind of homage to Frank Lloyd Wright and homage to Vincent van Gogh. And they are the bridge between the Western culture and the Japanese culture. And also, I want to point out the site plan of this museum. This is a typical urban design of Japanese small village. This is the center of the village. This is the main road to Tokyo. And this mountain is called Satoyama. Satoyama means the mountain village mountain. And in Satoyama, there is a shrine. This is a typical layout. And the meaning of this layout is the life of this village is totally relied on the village mountain, relied on the Satoyama, because the material came from Satoyama, and the compost, is also came from Satoyama, and it is very necessary for agriculture of the village, and energy, material, everything came from Satoyama. That is the life of Japan before 19th century. But in 20th century, as the age of as the industrializations, everything came from Tokyo. The energy, the electricity, the materials, everything came from Tokyo, and they forget Satoyama, suddenly they forget. And then they forget the shrine and Satoyama. The shrine is a big message. The message of shrine is to preserve nature of Satoyama is a strong message of shrine. But in 20th century, people abandoned Satoyama, abandoned shrine. And the message for my building is to look at Satoyama again, the before looking at the museum. And this is the site plan. Satoyama is here, the entrance here, the city center is here, and the parking is here. And when I showed this drawing to the mayor, he said, please move the entrance from here to here. He said, why you make the entrance so far from the parking? The entrance should be here. So I said, no, so Satoyama is more important than my building. And then after looking at Satoyama, the visitors should get in the building. And then the final is I can convince him. And then the building is can have a good relationship with Satoyama. And another finding of this project is a material. And in Japan, the carpenters are always saying the best material for the building is the material of mountain behind. And then I decide to use the local indigenous material as possible as can. For example, we use the rice papers, the craftsman of this village made, the local stones, the mountains, the mountain cedar behind, from the mountain behind. And through that practice, I learned how the local material can fit the local environment. Of course, the shape of the building is important, but in this building, the shape is very humble, and we designed a low building as possible as can. And what makes the harmony between environment and the building is the material. As the next project, again, I want to speak about Frank Lloyd Wright, because here is this is America's lectures, and it's a service kind. And so this is Imperial Hotel, the 1923, the same as that year, when the big earthquake happened. And the material is important, also for Frank Lloyd Wright. These stones. Oya stone. And before designing this building, Frank Lloyd Wright masters asked Japanese contractor to show every stone of Japan. And the contractor prepared every stone, marble, granite, sandstone, and finally he selected this sandstone. This is a volcanic stone. It's very soft, softer than sandstone. And the people are so surprised. Why is he selected such the weak, the fragile material for the gorgeous, the expensive hotel, Imperial Hotel? But the maestro didn't want to change his mind. This is his mentality. And the reason of his selection is softness. And he said, by the use of this soft material, architecture can be merged into the ground, and after his use of the Oya stone for the building, the Oya stone became a very, very popular material in Tokyo. And my next project, the location is very close to the quarry of that stone, and. And this is the site plan. Sorry, this is this is not working so well. I want to control the by the use of this. Sorry. Yes, I want to use this directory.
Yeah. Can you use it?
Yes. Yes. Okay. Sorry.
It does. Mm-hmm. Maybe we can try to load it.
I know.
Mm-hmm.
Should I use this? Mm.
You can advance with these two?
Yes. Yes. Okay, better. This is our design. I also want to create another softness by the new detail. This is the new detail. So we combined the the steel plate and the stone. The Franco Lloyd Wright loved the softness and the porousness of these stones, so I want to create another kind of porousness by the use of this steel plate. This is a kind of composite structures of stone and steel plate. And the steel plate is good for tension, and the concrete as oil stone is good for compression. And then my engineer is checking by his foot. And this is the facade. This is a new part of the building. And another material is adobe, so in Yamaguchi. Mm-hmm. In this village, before I started designing, I do the research, and I found this is a small warehouse. And it looks like the normal warehouse, but the detail is very different from typical Japanese warehouse. In typical Japanese warehouse, the structure is wood, and the earth is only the surface, the 2 centimeters or 3 centimeters is the surface. But here, the people made this as a small building by the solid adobe block. And also adobe block was the material of this the wall. And then I decided to do the kind of reconstruction of that method. But of course we have earthquake, and then we combine steel plate with this adobe block, and there's another composite structures. And also important thing for this project is start from the small small unit. And if we can make the building from a small unit, it's a kind of democratic construction method. Not the professional contractors can make this building. And actually in this village, the adobe block was used by the normal people, not by the professional construction company. And the contents of this building is a national treasure, the 12th century wooden Buddha. And another small element is bamboo. Bruno Taut loved bamboo, but he could use bamboo as a surface of interior and exterior, not structure. Because, as you know, bamboo has easy to as a crack, and not a good material for structure. And we found the solution. this is a solution. And the bamboo was used for the concrete formwork. And as you know, bamboo has those fillers. And we can cut those fillers. And then insert the steel and pour in concrete. And finally, we can make this structure. And after, we also made this kind of mock-up, comparing the dimensions, the distance, and the dimensions. And finally, we choose this detail. And this is the first bamboo house I made in Kamakura. Forget those neighbors. And this is the bamboo house, the second the floor. This is very transparent floors, and then the ground floors and second floors, the people can talk easily. No privacy, but this is. And the second bamboo house was in China. It's close from Great Wall. We didn't want to prepare flat land. So we want to follow the landscape as it was. The Great Wall was here. This is the most important place. So we call this space the void. This kind of void can connect environment and the building. This is a void. This is a void. And the Beijing Olympic is 2008. As a film director, Chang Yimou, he loved that building, and he shooted that building for the advertisement film, advertisement film of the Olympic. And probably, we cannot do anymore because Japan China the relation became very, very bad. But in 2008, the government used this building for their commercial as advertisement film of Olympic. As a very lucky moment for us. And the next project starts from Italy. It's a Milan, is a Castel Sforzano in Milan. And we are asked to design the temporary building. And our solution was coming from this small toy, a traditional toy of Japan. So the name of the toy is Chidori. And another small element. And people can make some kind of the structures by their own hand. It's a special joint. And the second bird, the third bird, and the turns of the second bird like that, and finish. It's very simple. And without any nail, and without any as a metal, as a glue, as we can fix very tightly. And we brought those bars from Japan. And the dimension of the bar is 3 centimeters by 3 centimeters, section is 3. And that means the only 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter is a connectors. And the wood is such strong as a material. And the next dream is to realize the permanent building by the same system. So we tested in our Tokyo University, as a structural engineer, Professor Sato, he tested that material, that system. And his answer is six, and the section should be 6 centimeters by 6 centimeters, but it can support that 10 meters high building. And this is a realization of the building. And again, no nail, no glue, no metal joint. This is interior. And you can see the glass which separates interior and exterior. And also this is the the small box so for exhibition. Again, the small element of the local material is important. We can make the building from bottom to the top. And same method for this bridge museum. This is a bridge museum. And the bridge museum is often have the roof for protecting the material. And then we utilize the bridge as a kind of museum. And in the same village, we designed this small hotel at the same time. It's Maluche Yusuhara. It's inspired by this material. This is a facade. And the stories is a hotel, and the three stories. And usually, we cannot use this flammable material for the facade. But we found a good solution. So this is not facade, we said. This is actually the window. So it is, there is a hinge, and we can open every element to introduce as a natural wind. And then finally we could get the permission from the local government. But they said it is very, very exceptional. And the next project is for the very unique client, the Starbucks. The location is also very unique. It is Dazaifu. Dazaifu is one of the major shrines here. This is Dazaifu. This is just in front of the entrance of Dazaifu shrine. So our proposal is the building. This is not interior design. So this system is supporting the building. We didn't want to repeat the same system of ZC Museum, and then this project joined like that. 30 degrees, the two bars, and the four bars were tied by this element. This is interior, and the joint is very, very difficult to make. And also, this is the structure of the building. And totally, we calculated the length of the bars, and the total is more than 3 miles, 4,000 meters. So the next two projects are the recently completed public project in Japan. It's another special location in front of this the Sensoji Temple, Asakusa. As it's in Tokyo, one of the oldest temples in Tokyo, Sensoji, Nakamichi Galleria, and the gate. The site is here. And this is our proposal for the competition. And the basic idea is it is 8 wooden houses. And before big earthquake, Tokyo was a city of those kind of wooden houses. The intimate space of the houses is fitting the Japanese lifestyle, and it is a tourist centers. And I would like to show that kind of intimate soft space for the tourists. And another good thing for this section is the discontinuity and the use of those spaces between roof and floor. And here we have the small theaters by the use of this stepping section. This is a completion as a Nakamise, this building, and the new Sky Tree Towers. I don't recommend to visit that tower. and this is so sad. And so this Nagaoka City Hall is also the new construction, the newly completed. And so this is the City Hall, and this is the station. And at first, the location is very important for this project. And in 20th century, the big public building escaped the city center because no big site for public project. And then the public project was sitting like around here, as an isolated concrete box from the life of the city. But the mayor of the city wanted to bring the public project to the city center, which is very close from the station. And he prepared that land. And my answer is the creating this space, as we called this space Doma, and inspired by the space Doma of this kind of a traditional Japanese house. In traditional Japanese house, this is a space for communication of the family with the village people. And also the material is very important, that this is made by the earth, clay, and then the softness of the material so reflect the activity of place. And we use earth for this space. And also the materials, again, the local material, local cedar, every material came from this city. And also this angle is for saving the energy. It protects the windows from sunlight. This is another as a sustainable as a device. The people of this Nagaoka city really love this building. And every day is like that. And after the completion of the building, every night, the mayor gave me the call to mobile, every night. And he was almost a drunken, and he called, Kuma-san, again, many people are coming to the city hall. It is very unusual, because city hall has no function at all at night, but people like to come here to enjoy the warmness of the material, the intimacy of the material. This is a self-controlling the window system with photovoltaic panels. This is a system for ventilation and the photovoltaic. The people come to dance for the space. This space is also open to the plaza. The secret. And recently we are adapting the method to the different contexts like Europe. The Besançon city center is close from the Swiss, and this is the site, the existing building. So our idea is very simple, to have the simple roof on the existing building with vegetation on top. And this is a void. Again, so that void is connecting river and the city. The material, so we can get the large easily from the mountain. And structurally, this is the mixtures of steel clamps and the wooden beams. Those are the wooden beams, and this is a void. And Frank Mausey is a foundation regional art contemporain. It's a kind of contemporary art foundation in Mausey. As I found this material in Mausey, it's a recycled glass. The effect is very similar to rice papers, and it's a detail. The planning is a spiral. It's a typical narrow street of Mausey is as a spiraling up to the top of the building. And the next material is this. This is a project in Naples. And the good thing as a, for us is the, as a people the often bring to a special place. This is a quarry. This is not my design. Looks like, but this is the quarries, typical quarries is a landscape. And we found the plant can grow from the street. Because that's tufo stone is very soft. And our idea is if we cover the building by this tufo stone, so naturally so we can have the vegetation on the building. And we are working with Italian stone company to have this detail for the building. So there combines the soft stone with a stainless mesh and epoxy, and they can tie it through the material. And so another so project in Spain is Granada Performing Arts Centers. As inspired, this time inspired by the fruits. As a Granada, name of Granada came from this fruits, pomegranate. As a small grain, as a, and big hole, as a particularization is also as a, can be found in this special fruits. And another hint is this Alhambra Palace. I like the ceiling design of Alhambra Palace, and it's not 90 degrees. It's a bit Islamic the geometry. And this is our fruits. The structure is honeycomb structure. And the small grain is supporting the whole building. So not supported by beam and column structure. And for interior, also people can feel the honeycomb structure. And this is connected with the structure on the facade. And then the intimacy can be created. The total is 1,500 the seat, but each space has only 50 seat. And then this space is called parterre. As the people here can feel the intimacy of space, even in the big volume. And Victorian Alberta Dundee is the branch of this museum in Scotland. Is inspired by this. Another small element. It's a Scottish is a creef, and the location is here. As the material is a small element is made by precast concrete. The piling, the stacking precast concrete like that, to creating holes, as a void. This void is connecting city and the river. This is view from river to the city. And besides those bigger projects, so we are doing the smaller project with a student. It's a tea house for the Frankfurt the Design Museum. And so it was designed by original building was designed by Richard Myers, 1973. And this is our project. And so when the director of the museum came to us, he said, please design tea house. But he said after that, don't use natural material. Why? He said, so if you use wood or as a clay or rice papers, after one day, the German vandalism destroyed the building. Why German vandalism is such the strong powers? And I asked him, should I use concrete like Tadawando? And he said, no, not necessary to be concrete, but it's a very, very difficult the request. And my final answer is like that. It's just a very temporary building. When people use that building, people inflate this membrane like that. And just 15 minutes, the people can build that structure. And like that. And so this is the plan. The outer skin and inner skin, those two membranes are connected by those strings. And this is a small door. It is called the nijiriguchi of tea house. And this is the sections. And this shows the strings which are connecting the inner and outer skins. And this is a nijiriguchi entrance, 60 centimeters by 60 centimeters. It is a rule of tea house. And this is the fires of tea house. And the material is called tenara. It's a Goatex product. Because flexibility is very necessary, and the normal membrane cannot be used. And then we use tenara for these soft structures. And next K-by-K project is also made by very unique material. That material is called shape memory alloy, and shape memory alloy is a special alloy is changing the form according to the change of the temperature. So this is the structure. The diameters of this the ring is 30 centimeters. The dimension is the 2 millimeters section, and this is very, very soft, and then we should have this form to fix the links, and then after take off the plastic core, so we can have this transparency, and this day. The temperature is not so high, and then the top of the dome was dropped like that. And the hot day, it raised, and this kind of the subtle movement. But if we can calculate carefully, probably it moves like the creatures. And one day I'd like to make that kind of soft building. And the next building is also the experimental project for the Milano Triennale event. The Casa de Tutto is the name of the event. And if you can understand Japanese, you can understand my joke. The Casa means umbrella in Japanese. And when I heard the event's name, Casa de Tutto, it should be the umbrella house. And this is umbrella we designed. And this is a kind of refugee as a house. And our idea is if everybody prepares a special umbrella in the entrance of the house, we escape, we can escape with that umbrella. And I think it's a very smart idea. this is the umbrella we designed. It's a very fancy umbrella. And the secret is this triangular pieces. And probably you know the Buckminster Fuller's flower domes, and his idea is the 20 facet is good numbers for making a dome. But here it's a 15 umbrella. And the 20 minus 15, so 5 is this. And then we can get 15 student, and in 5-6 hours we can make it. This is an interior, and the structurally, it is different from a dome. The geometry is similar, but structure is different because flat dome is supported by the flame, and then the flame is strong. But in this case, we combine the flame and the membrane as a four structural element. It's a kind of composite structure. So again, the membrane is worked as a tension, and the flame is worked as a compression. And then so we can reduce the size of the flame. And these ideas that we learned from umbrella. Umbrella itself is a membrane, is used for tension of the structure. And that's a triangular piece is used for window. Like that. And actually, we can live in that house. The material is very cheap material. It's a DuPont product, it's a Tyvek. And the next project is also start from Italy. They inspired this as a tank for construction site. So this is the first pavilion. So structurally, so this part is filled by water, so this part is blank as void, and then it's stable. And the next version is for the MoMA exhibition in 2008. It is called the water blanche. It is a longer version of the tank, and we made by this process. And we have two valves, and that have two valves means water can flow in this tank. And it's a joint system, and the water flows like that. And then this element, this wall, it can be used for wall heating, wall cooling, and then we can combine structures and the surface and the mechanical. After the MoMA exhibition, we realized that the experimental house in Japan, in Gallery Ma. This is a heat collectors outside. The water made by these heat collectors is used for the heating bed for bath and kitchen. And this is a system of water flows. So in my university buildings, we tested this system. And finally, we made it. This is the kitchen. The important thing is, from single element, we made it. So usually, many elements is necessary. We should buy many element. But in this house, the single element can make everything, including structures and mechanicals and everything. And even the electricity, we can generate by ourselves. And this is also relating to the lesson of big earthquake. In big earthquake, the Japanese infrastructure system was broken. And we know how weak the Japanese infrastructure system was. And then the self-sufficiency is becoming the theme of our recent project. And this is another experimental project inspired by the Ainu house, the Ainu lace house called Chise. It's very soft as a warm house because this is for the Hokkaido area. So they're utilizing the heat of the earth for warming up the house. This is our experimental house. And this is again, it's a two membrane. And outer skin and inner skin is are supported by those wooden frames. And this is a system of cooling and heating. And between the two the membranes, so we have the heating system, and naturally the air is circulating. And this is a fire. Even in summertime, we are using this fire to heat the land. And even at that time, we can pick up the heat from the earth. And this is the Lixil Foundation, the boats that big land in Hokkaido, and they decide to make the eco village in this big land. And every year, this is our first project, and every year they decided to make the one eco house, and designed by the student, selected by the competition, international competition. And this is our first test. And the second one is already is under construction by the design of Keio University student. And they continue to make the eco houses because still the big land exists. And in future, I would like to have the design of your university for eco house. And please try the design. And the last project I show you today is not architectural project. This is called the EJP. Means East Japan project, East Japan products. So when I was working for Tohoku areas, I found the craftsmanship there, interesting their craftsmanship can make. And the first one is furnitures inspired by this system again. This is a system. And by the use of the same material, we can make a shelf and the chairs and the table and but element is very, very simple. And also we are invited those young designers to design those kind of small products. Even from other Europe, we invited those designers. The second project is with this the old woman of Fukushima, and before we worked together, she made this kimono made by rice paper. And the rice paper is very strong and beautiful, and I was so impressed. And then I asked her to make this fan and this bottle. This is a bottle of sake. And this is a waterproof rice paper. And we began to sell those items in the small shops. And I want to increase the items because especially in Tohoku area, the best parts of craftsmanship remains. And so we want to pick up and vitalize those craftsmanship. It's also very important for the reconstruction of this area. And the lesson from the big earthquake is start from small things. Start from local material, so we can create by ourselves. And that, I believe, that is a new direction. Thank you very much.
So we can take some questions, if there are questions. No questions? Well, someone there?
Paper is interesting, and I'm wondering whether or not you are beginning to explore with any ways that some of these natural local materials can perhaps be combined with other elements to create new forms, new objects, new possibilities.
This is a question?
Yeah. Can you combine rice paper with other materials?
Yes. So now we want to use this material for the water brick project. The water brick project is made by the plastic, and always we receive the question, why you use plastic for the project? And then if I can use this rice papers for the water brick project, this can be very interesting. And it is very possible because this is a waterproof, as a material, so it can so make the water block, and now we try to do that project. And rice paper, I like rice paper very much because rice paper is softer than wood, and also the effect of natural light through rice paper is beautiful, and then the rice paper by the use of rice paper we can combine the light and the structure. This is the next direction of us.
Yeah.
Yeah, you were talking about establishing happy relationship between building and nature. What would be your recommendation to design for the context where the context is not friendly, where the context is not nature? Maybe it's a futuristic city, I don't know, in a society.
In the urban project, you mean?
I mean, what would be your recommendation to design in unfriendly context?
Unfriendly context? I think So even in the city, even the such density, still we can find some nature. And it looks unfriendly sometimes, but if we stay, we can find the natures even in that unfriendly situation. And for example, the wind is everywhere, the rain is everywhere, the light is everywhere. So we can enhance that kind of natural phenomena. It is very, very possible.
Yep.
Was it easy or difficult or expensive?
Or? Yeah, in Japan, I also doing the project in China and Korea, and not India yet, but in China and Korea, it is not so easy to find good craftsmanship. In some limited areas, they can create beautiful crafts, but for architecture and for the building, the craftsmanship and the building are separated in China and Korea. But in Japan, still, the craftsmanship and the building, the constructions are connected, has some relation. And also, those items are not so expensive in Japan. So, for example, my Starbucks, the cost of the Starbucks is not so expensive. The Seattle people said, okay, this cost is okay. And if we want to realize that structure in America or somewhere else, probably it's impossible. In Japan, still it's available.
Mm-hmm. One more?
Could you talk a little bit about the plans for rebuilding the areas that were destroyed and if natural materials or local materials are planning to be used?
The devastated area? Yeah, the problem of us is the government, Japanese government, is very, very slow, and still the master plan is not fixed. So, but we are proposing several projects for that area. And the refugee house provided from the government is made by the typical 20th century material, the steel and the cement board. And the, but if we can collaborate with the local carpenters and by the use of local materials, the cost is not so different from the standard, the prefabrication and the houses. And because of the Japanese the situation, the craftsmanship and the local material is not so expensive in Japan. And then I think it's a big possibility to work with that kind of material.
Okay, one more, that's all.
I thought it's very interesting how you use local material, local craft in your work. One thing that I was interested in knowing about is how this can be translated into buildings which are built on a larger scale, like your city arena project. Mm. Because one thing that I've, not to like round it off in one category, but one thing that I've noticed about Japanese architecture is the emphasis on detail, and it's beautifully done, unlike anywhere else in the world, as far as, you know, in my opinion. So how does that translate on buildings which are, you know, built on a much larger scale?
Yeah, so we already adapt that method to larger scale building. The Asakusa building, the stacking eight houses is building project, and Nagaoka City Hall project, this is not a small project. And in those buildings, we using local material as wood, rice papers, but we combine those local material with the steel structures as to combine is not bad, because I'm not fundamentalist. So if I worked with natural material, the fundamentalism cannot get a good solution. The good solution always come from some kind of mixtures, and that is the secret of my project.
Okay, thank you very much.